Bonjour tout le monde. What a pleasure to be in Dalhousie today. I want to start by thanking the extraordinary healthcare workers I got to meet and talk with a little bit about the challenges of the past couple of years that are ongoing. Je veux aussi remercier Sarah et toute la communauté ici pour l'accueil. I want to thank Jeanette, Dominic, Jenica, Serge, and especially René. Merci René de m'accueillir avec tant de chaleur, une journée froide, mais une foule accueillante ici dans la région. C'est un grand plaisir d'être ici. It's good to see Minister Fitch as well from the province et Normand, le maire de Dalhousie. Merci beaucoup pour votre accueil, monsieur. Merci d'être ici avec nous aujourd'hui. Before I begin today, I think we should all take a moment to remember the victims of the shooting in Nova Scotia that happened 2 years ago. To all Nova Scotians, your strength is remarkable. This is an incredibly hard day for the victims and for the families. We're thinking of you, and I want to take this occasion to really say that not just everyone here in New Brunswick, but everyone across the country is with you as you continue to grieve, as you continue to heal, as you continue to try and make some semblance of sense out of something that was absolutely senseless and horrific. We will be with you, and we will continue to be. I want to thank everyone here at the Dalhousie Golden Age Club for welcoming us today. I got to meet Sarah, the president of the club, and other members today. She talked about how people gather here to play bridge, meet friends, connect with a range of activities. And that's exactly right. When you're retired, you should be able to spend time with friends and family and doing the things you love without worrying about getting access to the quality of health care that you need and deserve. So as we recover from the pandemic, we have to address the existing challenges in our health care systems, including for seniors. So today, I'm very happy to announce, alongside the province, that we have a safe long-term care fund agreement with New Brunswick. The federal government will provide $22 million to improve care for residents of the province's long-term care homes and assisted retirement facilities. This will include hiring more staff and upgrading heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems. We know, especially on the staffing side, it's been an incredibly difficult 2 years as people have been overwhelmed with work, so much so that a lot of our frontline healthcare workers decided that it was time to take retirement or early retirement, which of course puts all the more pressure on people in the system. But at the same time, as I was hearing from Gaetan, Sonia, Claudette, Cindy, people are stepping up, people coming out of retirement, volunteers stepping forward from the community. But even as we saw Canadians stepping up for each other through this pandemic, we shouldn't have to rely on the kindness of each other to be able to get through the dark times. We should have strong systems in place. Alors, l'annonce d'aujourd'hui, c'est une bonne nouvelle pour les aînés au Nouveau-Brunswick et surtout pour tous ceux qui travaillent dans les centres de soins de longue durée. Parce qu'on sait très bien que la qualité de soins qu'on reçoit est directement liée aux qualités de conditions de travail de ceux qui sont là pour aider, pour soigner. Conditions of care are direct, and quality of care are directly related to the work conditions for the people who choose to work on the front lines to support our most vulnerable. And that's where we need to continue to step up for them. Tous les Canadiens méritent des soins de qualité, peu importe leur âge, peu importe où ils habitent. Alors, en plus de l'annonce d'aujourd'hui, je peux vous dire que dans le budget 2022, on a présenté plusieurs mesures pour rendre les soins plus accessibles pour les gens. On investit pour éliminer le plus rapidement possible les retards des centaines de milliers de chirurgies et de traitements qui ont été reportés à cause de la pandémie. On va aussi augmenter la remise de prêts d'études pour les médecins et les infirmières qui travaillent dans les communautés rurales ou éloignées parce qu'on a besoin que des personnes de qualité viennent s'installer pour appuyer les citoyens qui habitent dans les régions rurales et éloignées. We also know that science is key to improving well-being and quality of life, so we'll be continuing to invest in research to learn more about brain health and to improve treatments for people living with dementia. Of course, while we do all of this, we'll continue supporting mental health for Canadians. We know that mental health is health. And if we've learned anything from the physical health challenge that the pandemic has brought, it's that the mental health impacts were just as steep as people were isolated, as people were living through fearful, stressful times, as people went long times without their resource supports and networks to help them out. This is something that we need to continue to invest in across all orders of government, which is why the federal government is continuing to invest more in the Wellness Together Canada online portal to make sure that this free resource continues to be available for people everywhere in the country. En résumé, on fait ce qui est nécessaire pour améliorer les soins de santé pour les aînés et pour tous les Canadiens. On va continuer notre travail pour s'assurer que personne ne soit laissé pour compte. Before I end, I just want to share a little bit of an update on Ukraine. This morning, I had a call with President Biden and a handful of other global leaders. We continue to monitor the situation and coordinate actions to respond to Putin's terrible, illegal invasion. Today, Canada is imposing 14 new restrictions on 14 close associates of the Russian regime, including Vladimir Putin's two adult daughters, as well as oligarchs and their family members. This Russian regime and its associates need to continue to be held accountable for their actions. L'invasion injustifiée et illégale de Poutine a causé une crise humanitaire. Comme on l'a annoncé la semaine dernière, 100 membres des Forces armées canadiennes ont été déployés en Pologne pour aider les Ukrainiens qui fuient la violence, et on va continuer d'être là pour soutenir les réfugiés en Europe et accueillir ceux qui veulent venir au Canada.